Hello everybody, we are continuing down our path of campaign development, and the last class, which was about strategy, campaigns and tactics, was the most complicated and the most theoretical one that we had to face. And this one and the one after that, it's going to be more and more practical. So, if you, as you remember, in the last class we covered the pyramid of strategy, tactics, strategy, campaigns, and tactics, and the strategy being on top and tactics being on the bottom of this pyramid, and the campaigns being in the middle. And actually, we are going to focus on campaigns during this course. Last week we talked about goals, campaign objectives, and we talked about the SMART criteria for that can be helpful for writing and developing these goals. So what we're going to do now is we're going to talk about the campaign message. The whole process of campaign development can be divided into four steps that we explained last time, and I'm going to repeat them. First is the campaign objective. This is what we talked about last week, which answers the question, what do we want to achieve? Then there is the campaign message, which answers the question, what do we say? And for a human rights advocacy effort, it is probably the most important thing to be most carefully developed. And then we are talking about tactics. We're talking about things that we want to do as a part of that campaign. And finally, when we have all these things listed, then we can talk about the organization and resources, meaning how are we going to achieve all this. So we talked about objectives last week. We talked about the SMART criteria, which are going to help us come up with objectives that are specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and timely. And now we're going to talk about the campaign message. As you know, throughout the course, we're going to also, as an exercise, develop a campaign plan. And this campaign plan is going to have these four elements. So we're going to proceed step by step with the objectives. We're going to work on the message now. We're going to work on tactics. And then we're going to work on organization and resources. Mostly we're going to focus on volunteers. But in the end, we're going to wrap all these four elements together and come up with a campaign plan. So the more work you do throughout the course, the less work you will have to do at the very end. However, you should pick your own pace. These are the four things that need to be done, and the first one we already covered. So now we're gonna focus on the message. And in this class, we're gonna look at the process of message development. How do we come up with a campaign message? But before we do that, we will first ask ourselves, what is a message? How can we define a message? Are there any thoughts, ideas? Does anybody have any idea or definition or a thought what the message is, what is considered to be a message? Anybody? You can raise your hand and then, you know, you will have the floor. Okay, let's read it some other things that were written here. Something communicable for majority. Message is one sentence, tagline, the mission, an understandable sentence that explains exactly what we want to do and why, understandable for all. It's the essence of what you want the others to understand, probably in a compact way. Well, indeed, these are all things that are important for elements of the message. But in order to understand better what really message is, we need to understand that message is an important component, probably the central component of the targeted communication. And targeted communication is a communication which in itself is aimed at a particular audience, which is called the target audience. Which this audience needs to be carefully analyzed beforehand, because some of the audiences may not want to hear the message, so you may need to approach them more carefully. So the targeted communication is what we are going to talk about. So in this area, a message is, as many of you already suggested, is brief and straightforward statement, which is based on an analysis of what will persuade a target audience. So this means that the message is not just anything that you communicate. The message is something that you communicate to a selected audience based on the analysis of what is going to persuade them. That means that first you need to pick your target, exactly as somebody already put the question here. That means that you need to understand who is going to be receiving this message. And then, yes, as somebody suggested down here in the comments, so you already know your target, and then you figure out what the message is the right message for this target. Indeed, so this is the difference between just any communication and targeted communication. So message is part of the targeted communication. You need to analyze the target first and then to develop a message. So what we're going to do in this class is actually learn how to develop a message in targeted communication. So let's see what are some characteristics of the message. First, as many of you suggested earlier, it has to be simple, it has to be to the point, so it has to be condensed, it doesn't have many of the things that clog the essence of the message. It has to be really condensed, it has to be easy to remember, and it has to be repeated frequently. That is another thing. So the message in itself needs to be designed in such a way for it to be easily repeated. So if the message is something too complicated, then it is not easy to repeat it. So as somebody said, it's almost a slogan. Well, we'll come to that in just in a minute. I here put two symbols, which are from the Otpor campaign. One is on the left is the clenched fist, which was directly connected to our core message, which was resistance to the regime that is undemocratic. And on the right, we have a more targeted message, which was aimed at the members of the police. And so we have a picture of a police officer who has an Otpor t-shirt under his uniform. And this targeted communication was not resistance to the regime, although it is connected to that. This is a tailored message which says the members of the police force are secretly also supporting the movement. So you can see that, you know, the difference between the core message, the message that has no target, and the message that is tailored for a particular target, they have some things in common, but they have certain differences. And the most notable difference is that the tailored message is much more specific. So, but let's go more. We'll go more into the these specificities later. I just wanna answer the one of the comments here, which says the message is almost a slogan. Unfortunately, slogans are too short to convey the whole essence of a message. And when we develop messages, you will see how that we will need several sentences for a message. It's not going to be one slogan is going not going to be enough. But the message itself is used to produce slogans, posters, flyers, videos, speeches, any other type of material. So why do we have a message in the first place? First, because a campaign is a much broad, it's a broad enterprise. It requires a participation of great number of people, and all these different people need to be on the line when it comes to the campaign message. They need to have the message focus, and they need to have a message discipline. So the message, usually the format of the message is in talking points memo. It's a very short piece of paper which conveys the basic elements of what we want to say to a particular target audience, and the basic rationale behind it. So it's every talking point is maybe a sentence or two, and this allows people who are participating in the campaign to actually stay focused on the message. This also allows different people to produce slogans, posters, flyers, videos, speeches, everything that they want to do. So the idea of the message, development of the message, is actually that later on people can produce different material without waiting for the central, how shall I say, committee, planning committee to come up with that. They can do it on their own. So the message turns into a slogan. So we are going to do all this by ourselves, and we're going to go through the whole process of message development in a few minutes, and then you will see actually how the message will be turned into a slogan. This is actually a part of the exercise that we're going to do. Okay, so because it's actually much better if you go through that process than just to give examples. But before we go to that, I just want to say a few things about the messages that we're going to do. Because in political campaigns, there is a lot of message development that is compromising the whole field of campaigning, message development, and public relations, etc., etc. Where we are talking about political campaigns, especially today, and when we talk about politicians and people who are running governments, they rely on some weasel words, on some distortion of the facts. So we have things here that I listed. The political campaigns rely on factoids, they rely on buzzwords, they rely on people who are running the show, who are doing these campaigns, are so-called spin doctors or talking heads, spokespersons. And there is a great deal of framing and spinning going on. So does anybody have an idea what these words that I just listed here, what do they actually mean? Does anybody know what a factoid is? Okay, a factoid is something that looks like a fact, but it's actually a lie. And so there are a lot of things that may seem true, but they're certainly not. Probably the most famous factoid, which is not even political one, is that the only human-made structure that can be seen from the moon is the Great Wall of China. And a lot of people are repeating this, and it's just not true. It cannot be seen from the moon. So it looks like a fact, but it's actually it's not a fact. So the politicians like to use factoids a lot because it looks like they understand what they're talking about and that they master the facts, but they actually are telling lies. Does anybody know what the buzzword is? Okay, the buzzword, the fashion word of the day. Exactly, they are looking for something that is going to create a buzz, a word that is going to be repeated by the others, that will attract attention, etc., etc. And does anybody know what is framing and spinning as a technique in this political PR and campaigning? I think I can give a very another famous example about the glass that is half full or half empty. If you have a glass that is filled with water up to half, it depends how you frame it. Some people can say that the glass is half empty, and the other people are going to say that the glass is half full. So in terms of the content of the glass, it's the same, but the way you frame it actually makes a big difference. And this is another technique that the politicians like to do. So this is, you know, this was just one of the things that I wanted to mention, because this is not something we're gonna do here. We're not gonna learn how to make factoids. We're not gonna learn how to create buzzwords, or how to exploit buzzwords. We're not gonna become talking heads, and we're not gonna learn how to frame things and how to spin the story as they do in the political world. What we're gonna do is we're gonna talk about something that we mentioned 2 weeks ago. We're gonna talk about stories and how stories can be used in advocacy campaigns to develop and to pass on the message. So personal stories, how we're gonna use what we experience ourselves to pass on the message. We're gonna talk about memes. Memes, does anybody know what memes are? Memes are things that spread virally. So this is these are the things that spread over the today over the internet. These are the things that spread on their own because people are using them because they like them, because they think they're funny, because they think they're true, because they think like something like a smile icon. Yeah. Meme actually is a word that came out of the word gene for genetics, and because genes are hereditary, they go from parents to offspring and they pass on to the next generation. Then they said meme is something in memory that passes on from one person to another through word of mouth. So rumors, gossiping, fashion, these are the examples of different memes. Because these are the things, I mean, you can find them, if you're on Facebook, you can see certain pictures, photos, statuses that spread like a wildfire. Even, you know, their originator, the person who made that, they didn't know that this is going to explode. But it happens. So we're going to talk about that too. So when we talk about advocacy campaigns, we're not talking about spin doctors. We're not talking about talking heads. We're not talking about professional spokesmen. We are talking about activists. And these activists are actually spreading the message by telling their stories. And what is also important, they don't just talk. They walk the talk. So So there is that important component, is these are real people with real stories to tell and with real lives to share with others. So we're going to talk about stories, we're going to talk about memes. One said that's like the octopus who predicted the World Cup. Indeed, that was something that spread all over the world. And we're going to talk about activists, how they're going to spread the message, and we're going to talk about not just telling the stories, but actually living those stories and sharing them with others. So this means that we're not going to talk about the messages that we're going to talk about are not just about the information, they're also about the emotion. And unfortunately I didn't format this right. So what it should say down here is actually you must communicate not just to the mind but also to the heart. So this is this emotional component of the message. And I would like now to share one thing with you. This is a video that explains this what I was trying to say. Okay, I'm going to explain this video in a second.
What did you do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Excellent.
Okay, so I'm gonna briefly explain what the video is about for people who couldn't see it. So this blind beggar is sitting on the sidewalk and with the sign saying, "I'm blind, please give me some money." And everybody passes by and rarely people give any money. And finally one person comes over and changes the sign that the blind person holds, and people start putting money in. And the reason why they started putting money is that the new word said, "It's a beautiful day and I can't see it." So he's actually, you know, it's a very short video which explains that you can say the same thing in a more emotional way, and then people are going to be touched with that information. So emotion is also important. In human rights advocacy campaigns, emotion is important because we're not just informing people. We want people to act. We want people to stand up and fight for what they believe in. So the emotional component is also very important. So So I've listed some tips here. I'm gonna just run over them because we're gonna focus on those later when we develop the campaign. So the most important tip is that you need to know your audience, who the message is aimed at. Another important tip is you have to have clear goals and objectives of the campaign, so you know what you want to achieve. Message needs to be short and simple, and it needs to be personalized. It's not something that is sitting out there. It needs to be connected as a personal story to people who are actually going to spread this message. So finally, okay, we're gonna do the message development now. I actually want us to go through this very thoroughly so that we can actually go through the whole process of analyzing the audience, developing the message, picking the messenger, and then getting the feedback on what the impact of that message was. So the way we're gonna do this, before we start, are there any questions about the some things that we should answer before we go into the simulation exercise? Okay, if there is a question, please raise your hand and you can actually I can answer it now. Okay, I got a question to explain more about personalizing the message. Well, personalizing the message in the human rights advocacy campaigns means that, as we talked 2 weeks ago in the telling the story, when we talked about telling stories, personalizing the message means that this is something that needs to be personal in a way that there is a real person behind the message, or a real group of people behind the message that is being developed. It is not something, the message is not something that sits there without the person who is actually sending this message. Why is this important? It is important because we are not passing just information, we are also trying to pass the emotion. I'm trying to think of somebody put it well here, put yourself into the message. I'm trying to think of an example now. We can say that, for instance, when we look at the example that we used in the last class, when we talked about the Salt March and Gandhi, the way he put himself in the message by actually participating by actually going there to Dandi and taking the salt himself and making salt out of the sea, actually made this message personal, rather than saying it is not fair for the British to put the salt tax and they should abolish it. So you kind of put the personal in the story. And I can see here in the chat box that there are other examples that are listed here. But let's go to the simulation. And in order to understand the process of message development, we're going to step out of politics and human rights advocacy issues in that sense, but although this may be a human rights advocacy effort after all. And we're gonna talk about something that is universal enough that we can actually all be on the same page and much more easily understand each other. So in our simulation that we're gonna do in the next 45 minutes or so, we're gonna focus on the anti-smoking campaign, and so we are going to be a smoke-free anti-smoking advocacy group whose name is Smoke Free, and the symbol of this group is the is here shown on the right. So we're going to simulate the message development for the anti-smoking campaign, which is organized by this group called Smoke Free. And so this is what Smoke Free is about. This is the mission statement of our organization. Our vision is that our town is free from the harmful effects of tobacco. So this is what we want to see in the future. And our mission is to reduce tobacco use and exposure to secondhand smoke in our town through education, prevention and cessation support. So this is a pretty straightforward anti-smoking group called Smoke Free. This is their vision and this is the mission of our group. And so we're gonna look at the campaign now. We started a campaign. The campaign title is called Cold Drinks Clean Air. This is the name of the campaign. And the campaign objective is to establish within 3 months at least 5 smoke-free zones in taverns, coffee shops, restaurants, etc., etc., in partnership with owners of these establishments as the first step in a large effort to reduce exposure to secondhand smoke. So this is our campaign. We are trying to reduce secondhand smoke exposure in general. And so as a first step, we want to establish smoke-free zones, which means part of a restaurant where smoking is not allowed. And to do it not this is because we are an advocacy group, we cannot impose this law, we are not the government, but we have to do it in partnership with the owners of these establishments. So is the campaign, are we clear on this, on who we are and what we are, what the campaign is about? Because what we're going to look at now is the audiences here. Okay, so we're gonna look at the audiences. So these are the interested parties. First, we have vendors. Vendors go from one restaurant to another and they sell all kinds of things. They sell sweets, they sell nuts, peanuts and cashews and other nuts, and they sell cigarettes. So this is the first interested party that may be affected by this, because among other things they're selling tobacco. The second group is the students. These students, some of them do smoke, some of them don't. They are a rather mixed group. What they have in common is they need a place where they can spend their time. These places being mostly coffee shops, but they also go to restaurants. But their main interest is to spend some time in together. Some of them smoke, some of them don't. It's a matter of let's say social pressure or peer pressure among themselves. So the third group here we're talking about are restaurant and tavern owners. So these are the people who largely make their money by serving the people who come to have a drink or so. They don't sell cigarettes, they just sell food and drinks and coffee and that kind of stuff, but they serve smokers as well as non-smokers. And finally, the last group here are people who are smokers and who come to these restaurants and coffee shops, and they spend time sitting and drinking coffee and smoking. So these are the four target groups here. They're pretty much, you know, we're not going to go into any more detail. I think this explains a lot. So what we're going to do now is we're going to look at these four groups: vendors, students, restaurant owners and smokers, and we will position them on something that is called the spectrum of allies, and we will see how they fit into our campaign to reduce smoking in restaurants and coffee shops, meaning the campaign called cold drinks clean air, which is the goal of the campaign is to establish smoke-free zones in taverns, coffee shops and restaurants. So let's look at the spectrum of airlines. Oh yeah, I forgot this part. So when we talk about the spectrum of allies and when we talk about the target audience, we're going to answer some of these questions here. So let's focus on the first question. Who are potential allies in your effort when we talk about this campaign to establish smoke-free zones here? Who are the potential allies? Are there any thoughts? Does anybody have an idea who may be a potential ally in one of these four groups? Street vendors, students, restaurant owners, and smokers. Does anybody have an idea? Okay, so somebody thinks that probably students could be potential allies, meaning people that may potentially support this campaign. So this is something that we have to. These are the people that may support our campaign. They don't support now, but they may support in the future. So yes, potential allies are health conscious people, probably students. Maybe shop owners, maybe pregnant women and mothers. Of course, they are, I think, not just potential allies, they are already supporting this campaign. But that is almost a given. So potential allies may be students and restaurant owners out of those these four groups. The next question that we may ask ourselves is, are they willing to offer any concrete support? So what is a potential ally going to do to support this cause? Can we actually rely on these allies to do something about it? And this is another part of the analysis that we need to do before we develop the message. So we need to answer this question. Are they willing to offer any concrete support? The next question is, who are the potential adversaries in this struggle for smoke-free zones? What do you think? Who could be the potential adversaries in this zone? Alcoholic smokers, indeed. Yeah, and barflies. Smokers are potential adversaries, and they may see this as a big problem if smoke-free zones are established in bars and restaurants. And the main question is, how willing are they to put up a fight? Are smokers going to be a problem? Another potential adversaries are vendors who sell cigarettes. This is another potential problem, and they may also see us as a. And of course, tobacco companies are not just potential adversaries; they are our sworn enemies. They would like us to stop our campaign right away. But in this particular exercise, when we look at these four groups, we also need to see, is anybody still undecided? Is anybody still not thrown their idea in the or their thoughts about this issue in the lot? Because this may turn out to be the most important demographic here. And, you know, some may say that that some of the students here, some of the vendors may be still undecided. So we need to take that into consideration as well. So what is the way to proceed further? First, when we analyze the target, we need to see what are the potential allies, opponents, and neutrals in this campaign. So there is this thing developed by George Lakey from Training for Change, and I posted this I included this in the syllabus. This is the very short piece of text. It's maybe two or three pages. If you haven't read it, you should read it. And it's actually an explanation of a very nice tool, which is called the Spectrum of Allies, which was developed by George Lakey and Training for Change, his organization in Philadelphia. And this is a visual tool which allows you to put all the groups on the spectrum between active allies and active opponents. And this allows you to have an overview of all the groups, all the interested parties for your campaign. So let's try to put some of these groups on this spectrum of allies. So the way we're gonna do this is we're gonna use the text box here, and we're going to put different groups on different parts of the spectrum based on what we were doing. Based on the questions that we asked ourselves earlier. So, you know, here you can actually put different groups. The way I'm gonna do it is actually I'm gonna put the... Okay, so there it is. Active opponents, we're gonna put smokers there. I just wanna... Okay, so... Smokers are going to be put here as active opponents. And so we can have also street vendors here. Somebody said that they're also opponents. Okay, so street vendors are also here. Active allies, pregnant women, some students. Okay, we can have the restaurant owners. Somebody says that restaurant owners are active allies. Maybe not. We have to understand why would they be active allies. Maybe they're passive allies. Maybe they're passive opponents. Can you please explain why do you think that the restaurant owners could be active allies? Okay.
Okay, I think some restaurant owners can be active allies because it costs money and it costs resources to keep the restaurant from you know, having to deal with cigarette smell and smoke and complaints from, you know, clients. I personally feel like before we had the ban for the cigarettes in most of these places, especially eating places, people would complain all the time to establishment that there's a smell of smoke and let's not go to this restaurant because there's too many smokers here. So I think restaurants did used to lose business. So I believe that some restaurants to benefit from, you know, not having smoking in the restaurant. They will get more people coming in to eat.
So, some of the restaurant owners can indeed be active allies or passive allies for that matter, because they can also be sick and tired of having to listen to all the complaints from different customers. Okay, so we can say that so far we have pretty much analyzed the spectrum of allies, and we can say that the spectrum of allies actually is giving us an overview of where these people are and what is their attitude towards our campaign. So the spectrum of allies actually allows us to do one thing, and that is to slowly, as a goal of our campaign, to slowly move different groups towards our side on the spectrum. So the idea is not that we will turn smokers from active opponents to active supporters. That is not the very realistic. And as we remember, one of the criteria for the goal is to be achievable. So this wouldn't be achievable to turn active smokers from to turn smokers from active opponents to active allies. So this will not do. But what Spectrum of Allies actually allows us is to do something else, and that is to move everybody a little bit from a little bit to the left, to our side. So if we have pregnant women here, they're already our active allies. We're gonna try with our message to move our passive allies to become more active. We're gonna try to move people who are neutral to become passive allies. We're gonna try to move passive opponents, people who are opposing what we're doing but they're not doing anything much about it, to move them to be more neutral towards the thing. And we're gonna try to move the active opponents to be more passive opponents, so they don't put up a fight. So the idea of targeted communication is actually for each targeted group to have a specialized message that is going to move them a little bit towards our side. So the message is not one, meaning that we cannot tell them just, you know, smoking is bad, we should have a smoke-free zone, because most of these people are not going to relate to this message. Some people, like the smokers, they're going to see it as a threat. Some people as street vendors are going to see it as a problem because they depend on smokers. Restaurant owners are going to be maybe confused because they're going to think, well, this may be a good idea, but on the other hand, if I lose the smokers, maybe it's going to be bad for my business. And so the idea here is to, through analysis of the target, we're going to develop a better message. And this message is going to move the target slowly a little bit to our side. Once we are successful in that, then we can launch the next campaign that is going to move them a little bit more to our side. So the same logic applies to any human rights advocacy campaign, but we're going to stick to our anti-smoking campaign as the example. So is this clear? This is what we're going to do. Move everybody counterclockwise. Okay, so we are now going to go into the message box. And the message box is a tool that was developed for the purpose of election campaigns long time ago, and it was just something that was used for people to list what their statements are. But the message box evolved in human rights advocacy efforts as the tool to analyze the target. And the way we're going to analyze the target is We're going to answer four questions for each of those targets. The first question, which is going to be the same whoever the target is the question, what do we say about us? Who are we? What are we trying to do, and what is our goal, meaning the smoke-free advocacy group and our campaign to establish smoke-free zones. So this is the first question. We answer in the message box, we about us. What do we say about us? And then we have another question that we need to answer, and this is, what do they say about us? What does the target say about our campaign, about our group, and about our effort? In this first message box that we're gonna do, we're talking about vendors, people who are selling not just cigarettes, but also other things like sweets and candy and nuts and these kind of things. What do they say about us? Then we have to answer the question, what do we say about them, about our target group? And we need to answer the question, what do they say about them? So let's go step by step. We know what we say about us. We answer that in the mission statement. So I'm not going to repeat it again, but we want smoke-free zones. This is what we are about. This is our goal. This is what we want to say about us. But what do vendors say about us? We can let's put some of these things here too, which were listed. I'm going to write some of the things here. We are against smoking. We like people to have better health. Smoking people to have better health, etc., etc. So, what do we say about the street vendors? What is our message to the street vendors? What is the message we want to convey to them? Does anybody have an idea? What would be the message we want to say to the street vendors? I'm just going to comment on the things that are being written here. So, when we talk about street vendors, we need to have the message for them which says, what does this smoke-free establishment of smoke-free zones, what does this mean for them? You know, what are we going to have that impacts the things that we're going to do, how they're going to impact their business and their stuff that they're doing. So this is going to be the we about them. So then you can actually put the what do they say about us? What do the street vendors say about our campaign? This is an important part, because street vendors may see us as bad for business, exactly. So they can think that this campaign is actually going to hurt their business, and so they may be hostile to the campaign itself. But what do they say about them? What do street vendors say about them and their business? Yes, what they say is that the thing they want to do is they want to make some money because this is their job, this is what they do to make a living. So for them, it is not about the cigarettes. It is about, you know, making money. They if they could sell something else, they would. I mean, it's not, they're not especially attached to cigarettes as such. So let's see how to bridge the gap between the perception of street vendors and us. In our message, we need to play on the following misconceptions or the following statements that we singled out here. First, we need to, in our message, include that we respect their goal to make a living out of their activity. So this is something we're not aiming to stop that. So in our message, first thing we need to assure them, which is another thing, is that this is not going to hurt their business. So this is one thing. And another thing that we need to persuade them is that what we are trying to do is actually not going to hurt their business, and it's actually maybe going to help their business. And this is how we're gonna, this is what we can find from the message box. So the way to do it, and we will come back to it later, the way to do it is actually to explain to the street vendors in the following way. We know that what you're doing is the way you make money. This is your way to make money. And we do not wish to hurt your business. But we think that smoking is costing society a lot of money, that you know, we're trying to establish smoke-free zones in the restaurants, etc., etc., because we are against smoking, etc., etc. And these two things need to be reconciled. So this is the where ingenuity of message development comes in. We have the problem of trying to overcome the prejudices and misconceptions that street vendors have about the anti-smoking campaign. So for now, we're going to just leave it where it is. We singled out the problem, and we're going to come back to it when we develop the message. So let's go to the next group. What the we about us is actually the same as before, but let's try to do the other things. What is our message about to the students who just want to hang out and they want to spend time in the, this is their primary motivation, they want to spend time together in these coffee shops. And so what do we say about them? So yeah, one of the things that we need to talk about is socializing and smoking is now used as a form of socializing and is a result of peer pressure. But there can be other alternatives for socializing. So indeed, this is one thing, that this is a message that we need to. What do students say about us? What would be the biggest perception that they have on anti-smoking campaigns? Aha, that the smoking campaign is curbing their self-expression, that's a good one. This is something that they can see as limiting. And probably another way, or another attempt to control what they're doing. And what do students say about them? What do they think about themselves? This is an important part of the message. We are here to have fun, indeed. And they're free to do whatever they like. This is another thing with students. So here, as well as with street vendors, we need to first appreciate what they're doing and what they feel about themselves. So in our message, we need to explain to them that they should have fun and that they should be free to do whatever they like. And that we don't want to curb their self-expression. And we don't want to take away their cool factor. But we want smoke-free zones. And there can be other ways of socializing other than smoking. And there can be other ways, alternative ways for them to have fun. So this would be the way to pass the message to the students. Here we can see that from analyzing the target. So these are the things that our message needs to tell them. It needs to tell them that they should have fun and they should be free to do whatever they like, that we are not going to curb their self-expression, but that we want smoke-free zones and that socializing by means of smoking is not the only way of socializing. So let's move to the next group. What about restaurant owners? Here again, we are going to put the first is the same. We want smoke-free zones. This is our core message. This message doesn't change whoever is the target of our communication. Yeah, I mean, one of the comments here says about the students is that the message is to introduce another cool factor. Indeed, this is where we're going to go, and this is exactly what this sort of analysis is going to lead us to find the way to reach out to people who otherwise wouldn't be interested in what we have to say. So what we say about the restaurant owners, we don't want them to lose business, and we want them to make more business by actually having customers that don't want to sit in smoke-filled rooms. What do they say about us? Well, what they say about us is probably similar to what the street vendors are saying. They may be afraid that this may hurt their business, and so what they would like us to do is actually to leave them to whatever they're doing. So somebody said here, please do not disturb us. And what do the restaurant owners say about themselves? What they would like to think about themselves and what they usually say about themselves? Any ideas? Free business? Similar to street vendors, they also want to make money. This is what they do for a living. This is not something that they would, that they would prefer smokers if smokers weren't buying drinks and food in their restaurants. The reason why they like people in their restaurants is because they're customers, not because they're smokers or non-smokers. Okay, so another thing that what they think about themselves is very important, that is listed here, is that they want to care about their customers. And this can be an important segue into passing the message about smoke-free zones. So when we when we deliver a message to owners of restaurants, we need first to appreciate that their business is important to them, and this is the way they make a living. And we need to appreciate, and we also need to tell them that we know that they care about their customers, and that we don't want to hurt their business, similar to the street vendors. we need to kind of, in the message, explain that we don't want to hurt their business. And we need to explain that they will probably have more business if they dedicate some zones in their restaurants for people who don't like to sit in smoke-filled rooms. So, caring about customers, which is an important part of what they think about themselves, can be transferred into a message that they should care about their non-smoker customers too, by establishing smoke-free zones. So here, in the analysis by using the message box, we can actually already see the glimpses of the message for the restaurant owners. Because as you remember, in the campaign objective, the way we're going to establish these smoke-free zones is in the partnership with restaurant owners. So they're the most important partner for this particular effort. So let's go to the next group, which are the smokers. Again, we want smoke-free zones, is what we say about us, but let's fill the other three boxes here. We about them. It's a tricky one, because if we look back at the spectrum of allies, what we want to achieve is to move smokers from active opponents to passive opponents. So this is important. We're not going to change their mind with our campaign. They're still gonna be opposing what we do, but they're just gonna be less active in this opposition. So yes, in the message box about smokers, we need to tell them, you can still smoke, but we have to have our own section. Okay, this is an important part. What do they say? What do they say about us? They're destroying my fun. They can harm themselves, but not others. This is another thing what we say about them. And what would be something that what they say about themselves? What do smokers usually say about themselves? They usually say that they are the endangered and, well, as long as I can smoke, then I'm happy. Okay, this is true. But also, the people who smoke often see that they are threatened by people who are trying to prevent smoking. So they have this kind of endangered species kind of attitude. Okay, so here is what we have as a result of the message book for smokers. So, what do they say about themselves? What they want to do is smoke. This is what is their most important thing. And what they see us as somebody who can jeopardize that and who can threaten their smoking habit by introducing certain bans. So when we are developing a message intended for the smokers, we need to tell them, okay, you can smoke, and this is fine. We're not going to destroy your fun in smoking. We just want to have our own section where we are not going to be exposed to your smoke. And the message can also go, you're not going to, at the same time, you're not going to be exposed to our nagging and our complaints, because we're going to be in a separate section. So you're not going to have a problem with us. We're not going to have a problem with you. So this is the way to frame the message for smokers. But as you can see from this message box, the smokers are not our primary target, and the smokers, that's why we don't have such a powerful message that should be prepared for smokers, because we're not gonna get smoke-free zones by persuading smokers. We're gonna have smoke-free zones by persuading restaurant owners. The only thing we wanna do with smokers is to kind of calm them down so they don't create much trouble. Because if we have a message towards the smokers that is going to irritate them, that is going to make them angry, then they're going to put up a fight. And if they put up a fight, we're going to have more trouble convincing the restaurant owners that we should have smoke-free zones. So, targeted communication, in an essence, is distinguishing different targets and figuring out who you want to see where and how do you want different targets to behave. So by analyzing these targets, you can actually develop messages for each of those, or for each of those targets, so that these messages are then compatible, they don't fly into the face of one another. Okay, so we have a quote from Sun Tzu here. It is said that if you know your enemies and know yourself, you can win 100 battles without a single loss. Indeed, this is what we would like. This is what we would like to have, and this is the reason why we have to put so much effort in analyzing the target before we go into the implementation. So let's go back and look at these four message boxes again. So we have to persuade vendors that this is not going to hurt their business. This is the most important thing here. And that, you know, they don't need to, first they can sell cigarettes still, but they can also make money by selling peanuts and other nuts. And when people don't smoke, they tend to take more nuts. That this was proven to be a regular behavior. So one of the ways we can turn this message into an action is by organizing peanuts eating week in restaurants where people are going to be buying peanuts from the street vendors, and so they would be then encouraged to kind of support the idea. But again, they are not our primary target. So let's go to the next group. Students, what they want to do? They want to have fun. So the message to them is something that is going to make them cool. And we'll come back to the one of the comments here. Message is to introduce another cool factor. Something that is going to make them look cool, and some activity that is going to allow them to socialize without smoking. But again, this is not our primary target. When we look at smokers are a potential trouble. They are our opponents. They may cause trouble. So what we want to do with smokers in our message is we want to lower their enthusiasm. We want them to, you know, still don't like us and don't like the idea of smoke-free zones, but they say, okay, at least we're gonna have our own section in the restaurant where we can smoke. So the message to them, or a slogan, is, you know, that the smoke-free zones are going to be complaint-free zones for them. So nobody's going to complain about their smoking anymore, because we're going to establish complaint-free zones where they can actually smoke without any complaints. So this would be a message for them. But the most important group here and the target for our campaign is the restaurant owners. So for them, the message is that We want smoke-free zones, we are your customers, and we know you care about your customers, so you should care about your customers who don't smoke as well by establishing smoke-free zones. So this is the message, and this now can be turned into a slogan. And here is where creativity comes in. How do we make these slogans? This is something we're gonna focus on more in the next class. We're gonna talk about the message and the messenger. We're gonna talk about the from this analysis that we now looked at. We're gonna look at how this message is developed and turned into a message carrier. As McLuhan said, Marshall McLuhan, in his book, which was printed, I don't know how many years, decades ago, he said that the medium is the message. And actually, you know, some people say messenger is the message. And it depends on how you convey the message and through which channel and how you actually pass on this message. This is going to actually influence the message as well. And this is actually part of the message. So next week, we're going to talk more about different ways to convey the message. Mostly, we're going to talk about digital communication. And we're going to talk about different ways. Videos, blog posts, pictures, infographics, and other ways to convey the message. But it is important, again, to come back to the to something that we mentioned several times, and this is to personalize the message, because the message that is not personalized is not going to be as powerful as the message that is coming in the form of a personal story. So this short simulation that we went through about anti-smoking campaign, we didn't create the message yet. And the reason why we didn't create the message yet is because this is a creative process. We didn't have time to come up with wording that would be precise, that would be specific, that would be to the point, that would be easy to repeat for each of those messages. But we, through the analysis of our audiences that we did in the message box, and with the use of Spectrum of Allies before that, we actually pretty much have all the ingredients for a successful message development. So we're going to continue on the forum. We're going to continue with the anti-smoking campaign simulation. And in the forum, we're going to create some of the slogans and messages for these groups later on. But before we do that, do we have any questions before I talk a little bit about the assignment for the next week? Any questions here? Okay, we have a question.
Hi, and thanks for today, Ivan. My question is related to ethics of sending a message. Are we allowed to use children as a target group, let's say not in the smoking example, but in a campaign for encouragement, encouraging people to use seatbelts? Can we go and talk to children and ask them to talk to their parents?
Okay, this is an important ethical question, and there is a lot of concern to be made about the misuse of children in targeted communication. You can see that by all the big companies that are, you know, trying to sell products by targeting children directly, and because children don't have that sort of critical distance that older people have towards so they're much more easily manipulated. And so we can see that this is an important ethical question. So the main question here is who benefits from this targeted communication? Because if we are talking about the campaign that is targeting children, but for the benefit of that of those children. Like, for instance, a campaign that is going to promote the use of seat belts or better behavior in the street when it comes to traffic, and that is going to limit the number of traffic accidents and that kind of stuff. Then you know the goal and the objective would justify targeting children. But if the case is the pure manipulation, like in the case of many of the companies that are trying to sell toys or that kind of stuff to children by aggressive marketing, that at least in my view is totally unethical, and I would never suggest doing something like that. So yes, as one of the comments here, I'm just reading the comment that you cannot rely on analytical thinking ability of children. So that is the most important obstacle for that. But there are campaigns aimed at children, and as I said, there are examples where you actually are allowed to do that, but it needs to be in the benefit of those children. For instance, a campaign that will educate children how to cross the street, or that they shouldn't, I don't know, I'm trying to think of something else, but this is something that we were exposed to when we were children too. So otherwise it's highly unethical. Campaign: do not talk to strangers. That would be an interesting one. But again, this is something that is very, very specific and very, very aimed at children. We have something else here, and that is, you know, the young people. So we're now talking about people over the age of 18, and we're talking about people who are capable of reasoning, so they're not considered children anymore, but they still have, because they're young, they still have much bigger rate of communication with other people. They're much more dynamic, and therefore they're actually very good in as not as targets of campaign, but as actually people who are participating in the campaign as part of the campaign. And so this is something we're going to talk about in 2 weeks when we talk about campaign organization. We talk about volunteers. So there, we're not talking about children, we're talking about young people, but these young people can actually be vehicles and driving force of the campaign. So we're gonna we have to finish soon, so let me spend one more minute on the assignment. We're gonna continue our simulation exercise in the next couple of days, the anti-smoking campaign exercise, and we're gonna come up with the slogans and message and other forms of communication for that particular campaign. But you have the big campaign that you're working on to think about too. And so one of the things that you're going to do in the, yes, and you can work on parallel, and I'm going to be helping you with that. The final campaign is going to be due December 4th. So we have more than a month to complete it. So we're now going step by step. Well, not more than a month, but less, a little bit less than a month to complete it. And we're going step by step. So we still have plenty of time to do it. I just want to introduce this second part of the campaign plan, which is to develop the primary message. This is the message for the primary audience, primary target. As in this simulation, we actually realized that our primary target were the restaurant owners. Here, each of you will define the primary target of your campaign, and you're going to develop the message by using the message box tool for that target. You're gonna explain all these, answer all these four questions: we about us, we about them, they about us, and they about them. And you're gonna present this in three paragraphs, 250 words, which is the message. And the message is going to contain key concepts that are going to be part of the campaign, but it is not going to be a slogan, a flyer, or any other product that is going to carry the message. This is not going to be something that we're going to think about now. This is something we're going to do a week from now. So just now focus on the essence of the message, not on the carrier, not on the way this message is going to be disseminated. So, and this assignment is due next Monday, and we're going to continue the discussion on the forum, especially the simulation. And in the next day or two, I would focus on the simulation, because that's going to answer a lot of questions about the message development that we didn't cover in the class. And for next Monday, the assignment using the message box tool. If there are any assignments from the last week that are that were not finished you were not able to post them because of the technical problems or whatever other problems, we still, as I said, we still have time, so it's not really a problem. But please make sure that you post them. Okay, I kept you long enough. It's already 8:01, so thank you very much and have a good week.
اگر بارها دنبال واژه آموزش گشته اید ولی با درهای بسته روبرو شده اید، اگر دنبال آموزشکده گشته اید که دور نباشد و استادهای خوبی هم داشته باشد، اگر مشتاق آموختن هستید اما توانایی مالی کافی نداشته اید که بیشتر و بیشتر بخوانید و بدانید، اگر شبها وقت آزاد دارید و روزها نمی توانید دنبال درس و کلاس بروید، توانا بهترین انتخاب شماست. توانا بود هر که دانا بود. توانا رایگان در اختیار شماست. آموزشکده‌ای در خانه شماست. هر وقت که بخواهید، شب یا روز. با درس‌هایی مانند حق و حقوق زنان، دموکراسی، تفسیرهای نوین و لیبرال از دین، حقوق اقلیت‌ها، حکومت قانون، نهادسازی و نهادهای مدنی، محیط زیست، روزنامه نگاری و امنیت فضای مجازی و موبایل های هوشمند. آموزشکده توانا کلاس های دلخواه شما را رایگان به منزل شما می آورد. در کلاس های توانا با نام و جیمیل مستعار ثبت نام کنید. برای ما مهم انگیزه شهروندی و علاقه شما به آموختن است. ما هرگز نام واقعی شما را نمی پرسیم. تیم فنی توانا از طریق سایت تواناتک به شما کمک می‌کند تا با خیال راحت و فارغ از دردسرهای امنیت وب در کلاس‌ها شرکت کنید. در توانا بیاموزید، با تواناتک پاسخ سوال‌های فنی خود را بگیرید و از صدها کتاب، ویدئو، آدیو و مدرک دیجیتال در کتابخانه توانا رایگان استفاده کنید. توانا پنجره آشنایی شما با جهان ایده های نو و تجربه مردم دیگر کشورها در گذار به دموکراسی. برای دسترسی به توانا و اطلاعات بیشتر به فیسبوک، توییتر، یوتیوب و گوگل پلاس توانا و تواناتک بپیوندید.